one thing students have to understand is, despite the how heavily the exams are weighted, they are only 3 hours, and we're not machines. I mean, it's not, the expectation can't be that you get everything numerically correct in the end. 10 mark question, the correct answer is 1, maybe 2 out of 10, right? Most of it is hitting the key dot points that the lecturers want to see, and so I guess part of doing well on exams is working out what the dot points are. You're just trying to show that you know what you're doing. That's what an exam is, and so that's why the answer isn't as significant. Still significant if you want to get 100%, of course.
In high school, it's a lot of, I guess, shorter questions. So when you do a test in high school, you might have 50 questions, and they all have, you know, a yes or no answer, and there's a right or a wrong, and you either get the mark or you don't get the mark. Whereas at university, because the questions take such a long time to get the answer actually isn't really very important at all. It's the process of finding the answer. So it's more about making a logical, coherent argument, which I think a lot of students coming from high school really struggle with, because you're used to just, you know, you get the right answer, you get all the marks. But that's not what it's like at university at all. You really need to be able to explain things. And lots of students think that you don't need to use language in maths, but if you don't write any words on your maths assignment, you're probably not going to do very well at university. So you need to actually use a lot of words. There's a lot of language, and language is really important in maths.
The best practice for a marathon is to run a marathon, right? Like, the best practice for doing an exam is to do an exam and to put yourself in a situation that's going to be as similar as possible. So, you know, putting all your distractions aside, just sitting down for 3 hours and going, right, I'm just going to see how much I can do of this. And the first time you might only get one question done, or you might get two questions done. That's okay, like, at least you're building up, you know, you're getting used to that situation, because it is a quite unique environment, you know, sitting down, because maths exams are generally 3 hours, sitting down and working consistently for 3 hours with no distractions. That's, you know, you need to practice at that. So yeah, closer to the exam, do exams. The Uni Melb Library has past exams for a lot of undergraduate subjects, so you can, there's lots of resources out there to practice. So you could probably do a practice exam, you know, two a day and swap back, and you still wouldn't get through all of them. So there's lots of resources out there. It's just, you know, making sure that you actually sit down and do it.
If you're working on your own, I guess the biggest advice I would give is, like, don't skip steps. So what a lot of people do when they're by themselves practicing problems is they kind of skip some things, and then they get to the end and they get the wrong answer and they don't know where it's gone wrong. But every time you skip a step, you're actually skipping a level of thinking. So that means you're more likely to make a mistake, and you're not likely to know where the mistake was made. So the advice that I would give is, if you're attempting problems by yourself, or even not by yourself, even if you're seeking help, do them slowly. You shouldn't be in any kind of hurry when you're doing a maths program, problem. You want to just take your time and work through it and make sure that every single step makes perfect sense to you before you proceed to the next step.
Being able to check your own work is really, really, it's a really, really important skill to have. But for some reason, it's that extra 10% of work you have to do that not many people seem to want to do. That's probably the best first step you can make. Once you think you've answered the question, actually check if you have answered the question. And there are so many tools for doing that.
You should definitely go to the website Wolfram Alpha. So if you Google the words Wolfram Alpha, even if you misspell it, Google will figure it out. And you can type in any equation or question that you want, and it will give you a solution. So if you're just looking for the answer, that's actually really easy to find, even without process.
For me, I think the learning style suits me most is, like, revising the lecture recordings. And if I still have some clear understanding, I will go for the textbooks and consultations. I feel like active learning would be more helpful than the passive learning.
One of the things that really actually helped me was I started going to consultation hours. So for mathematics subjects, the lecturers put aside an hour or 2 hours a week where you can go and speak to them about the subject. So I started going along to those, and just having someone to talk with you what it is that you're actually meant to be doing was really helpful. So I think part of the process of overcoming challenges is not being afraid to seek out help. Because I feel like a lot of students in maths classes, and certainly this was the case for me as well, you'd be so afraid of getting it wrong or not having the right answer, so you don't say anything. You just sit there quietly and don't ask any questions. And then you don't learn anything because you haven't been able to express what your problem is to anyone else.
One thing that I do is ask someone else. So I found in undergrad, but also particularly even more important now in masters, is your cohort and like the people you're in classes with, the people in your tutorials with, are such a great resource. The lecturer definitely has time, like in contact hours, that's super valuable, but you're seeing your classmates a lot more often, and you know, sometimes you understand something better than someone else and they understand something better than you, and even just a really short conversation can like, you know, change your thinking and help you understand something better. So yeah, in terms of understanding and like learning in maths, like other people and classmates have been absolutely pivotal for me.
Also form study groups. I've always found that, you know, studying alone during SWAT vac is really ineffective compared to working with others as well. Really going through it, because again, consultation times are finite, but if you've got a study group, that's a lot of time to really work stuff out.
Because for the common subjects, we do provide formula sheet in the final exam. So if you could study from the formula sheet, you know what kind of equations will appear on the exam, and you know how to approach those questions by applying related equations. That would be really helpful.
The kind of questions you're getting have been asked at every university around the world as well, and has been asked at Melbourne Uni lots of times. There's so many resources out there that you can find. So if one explanation isn't quite clicking, or you didn't quite understand, like I'd always try and look up a YouTube video or find some other resources online.
So if I was going to Google something, if it's an equation, I wouldn't Google it. I would go to Wolfram Alpha. But if it's a concept, I would Google the words. So a key part of mathematics is knowing the keywords. So if I know that I needed to Google, let's say, linear independence, for example, that's the word that comes up in a first year subject. So I would Google the words linear independence. And then your top hits would probably be like your Khan Academy or YouTube. And I would watch the videos and actually have it explained to me. So that way I've had a different perspective. It hasn't just been the lecturer.
You know, I had to accept, like in first year, just go for 100. You want to get everything perfect. But then in these later ones, you know, 100 becomes, you know, an 85 or whatever, because you're just like, okay, I'm going to just give it a good shot and do my best. And
what I usually do, and I've done this before, if I can't get the answer to the first part, I'll say, pretend that this is the answer for the second part, and because the logic will still follow. So I'll say, okay, I couldn't figure out part A of the question. In part B, I'll say, I couldn't figure this out, but I'm going to pretend that this was the answer. Which sounds silly, but because you can actually still use that answer to show some kind of reasoning, they still accept at least part of that. So if you can't do it, just make up an answer essentially and use that for the following parts if you're confident that you could know how to use that.
Doing something that you find enjoyable for the 30 minutes beforehand before an exam is really helpful. So on your way there, or like when you get to the venue, you know, just doing something that you like for half an hour. So maybe listening to some songs that you really like, maybe going for a walk, maybe calling up a friend and like putting things in perspective a bit, just to take your mind off something. And I always find that the exams that I've accidentally bumped into a friend going into the same exam or to the same building, and I've had a chat for 30 minutes, I feel so much more relaxed when I get in there, because my brain has been doing something else for just, you know, even a really short amount of time beforehand. And obviously, like, get enough sleep the night before. If you're running on like a few hours sleep, nothing's going to work well, even if, you know, even if you do know the stuff.
Because you just don't know when you're talking to people if they might ask and might not.
And I also think it's confidence a lot. Like in maths, everyone feels stupid. It's hard. Like no one is good at maths. Like I go to multiple seminars every week, and some of them just make no sense, and you're like, can I ever be as good as these people? Like, it's just makes no sense. But then all of them, you can tell on days when they're trying to learn new things, struggle so much. And I think just trying to constantly talk to others and say where you're wrong, rather than being cocky about how good you are at maths, because no one is good at maths, and you just really grow by just keep pounding questions and trying really hard to understand something.
It's one of those subjects where it's really easy to get a fixed mindset, like, And as a maths student, you hear so many stereotypes. Like if you say, oh yes, I'm studying maths, the first thing people say is, oh, I was never good at that, or like, I was bad at that in school. But then no one will ever say that about any other subjects. They just do it about maths. So I think it's it's really easy to get into that mindset of if you don't understand something straight away, like that it's not for you. Especially when I first started uni and started in maths, like coming from a really small class and thinking that I was, you know, pretty good at it, and then being in this massive lecture theatre with lots of other people who, you know, you perceive as being so much better than you. I definitely have felt that, like, many times. I think the answer is just to realise that the people that you think are geniuses, they're spending so much more time with it than you realise. Like, they might either pretend that they're not doing as much study or just don't talk about it, but they're actually, yeah, the people that understand it are spending a lot of time thinking about it and working on it. And once I realised that, it was kind of, you know, put some of those fears to ease a bit. But it's definitely still something that I think about a lot.
Don't feel like you have to memorise mathematics or do it. Just enjoy problems and jump from one to one. And I think if you just enjoy it and really get into the problems, you won't find it too stressful. And yeah, and just can't, I think, yeah, just be persistent, keep working hard, because you'll get through it and you'll really enjoy it as long as...